أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين. صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، يا رحمة الله الواسعة، ويا باب نجاة الأمة، ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة، يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء، يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل لا يعلم من في السماوات والأرض الغيب إلا الله، وما يشعرون أيان يبعثون. صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
A second for the love of Imams Al-Hasan Wal-Husayn.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
A third for the love of Fatima Az-Zahra with your loudest voices. There is no doubt that we are living at an age of mass information. Knowledge is widespread everywhere. People are a lot more educated today than they were in the past. Today, as things have become more modern, we see more advancement, we see scientific, technological, economic advancement. This is the age of knowledge. This is the age of education. This is the age of information. People know today a lot more than they knew in the past. If we compare our generation to previous generations, our generation by far is more educated and knows more than the previous generations. However, even though our generation is the most educated generation and has more knowledge and information than previous generations, we still see certain things that exist that are quite surprising. such as fortune telling. Fortune telling today is a multi-million dollar industry that makes a lot of money, that has a lot of customers. Even though we live at a time where you would expect people to be educated, you expect people to be better, yet even today there's a need for fortune tellers. People want to know their fortune. People want to know their future. What will happen to them in the next 10 years or 20 years? There are still customers. Now, when I say fortune telling or fortune tellers, this can include horoscope, those that are interested in reading the horoscope. You know, in a lot of newspapers, there's an important section, there's a big section for the horoscope. Why? Because there's people that are interested, people that would like to read it almost on a daily basis. This could include tarot card reading. This could include palm reading. This could include crystal balls, telling the future from crystal balls. This could include fortune tellers that claim to have communication with the jinn or with souls of dead humans. This could include opening the Quran and trying to tell the future from the Quran. These are all various ways that are used by Muslims and non-Muslims alike. These are various ways that are used in the East and in the West in order to tell people's fortune. This is not just a phenomenon you would think only in America or in Canada or in Europe that people would like to know their fortune. No, this is a phenomenon that exists among Muslims and Islamic countries. I remember a couple of years ago, there was a show, perhaps the show is still on, I don't know, but it got very famous a couple of years ago. In the Middle East, a man who claimed to tell people's fortune, he could tell about their past and could tell their future, and he claimed to be in contact with the jinn. He claimed to, you know, have friends from the jinn, and they would tell him people's future. And this program was extremely popular. In the evening, everyone was watching this show. And this was in Islamic countries. People where you would think, you know, in areas where you would think these people have enough Islamic knowledge and enough Islamic education to know that these people are all crooks. Yet nevertheless, these people, such shows, and this business, the fortune-telling business, is quite widespread among Muslims and non-Muslims. Tonight, my dear brothers and sisters, we'd like to examine, first of all, an analysis of why do people want to know their future? Why do people go to fortune tellers? What is it that drives people to want to know their future? So first, let's examine that. Two, what does Islam say about fortune telling? Can we go to fortune tellers? Can we depend on them? Can we depend on the horoscope or tarot card reading or the palm reading? Or can we depend on them or no? Does Islam allow us or does Islam not allow us? Number three, what fortune tellers say. Now, besides the point that does Islam allow us or not allow us, what they're telling us, is it true or is it false? When you go to a fortune teller and the fortune teller tells you that so-and-so is going to happen, you're going to marry this person or that person, or you're going to find a job in this city or that city. Is this true or is this false? These are all a bunch of lies. Now stick with me as we take this journey tonight and we try to discover the answers to these questions. Wa salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. First of all, why are people interested in knowing their future? This, the fortune-telling industry, this industry is not something new. It's a very old business that existed from the days of the prophets. Even perhaps before, there were astrologists, there were fortune tellers, there were magicians, kahana meaning fortune tellers, munajjimeen meaning astrologists, sahara meaning magicians. There were a lot. You would find them everywhere. And it was a very well-known business that would make money. They had a lot of customers. It goes way back. This is not something new. In fact, most of you know in the story of Prophet Musa alayhi salam. Prophet Musa, when he was born, the year that he was born, the Pharaoh of the time, Pharaon, astrologists, Munajjimeen, they came and told him that this year a child will be born that will kill you in the future. He will kill you. They told him. And what happened? He ordered that any woman that is pregnant, you take out the fetus, you abort the child, and you kill the child. And that's what happened in that year. يستحي نساءهم يذبح أبناءهم ويستحي نساءهم. He would leave their woman, he would abort their children, and he would kill these children. Thousands of children were killed. Why? Because the astrologists had told Fir'aun that Musa will be born that year. Thus, there were astrologists. People depended on them. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam was asked, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He was asked, and this hadith is in Al-Ihtijaj, he was asked by an atheist, that where did fortune tellers come from? Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he told him that during the days of Jahiliyyah, they came during في حين فترة من الرسل, meaning whenever prophets did not come, soothsayers and fortune tellers would come and fill in their place. So if in a couple of years, decades, there was a prophet, and then that prophet died, and there was no other prophet till another decade or two decades, within that period, fortune tellers would appear. They would take advantage of that period where there's no prophets, and people would come to them. People were fooled. If this person could tell the future once or twice, or he would guess, people would think that this fortune teller has supernatural abilities, supernatural powers, so they would depend on him. In fact, he would be the judge. If two people were in an argument, they would come to these fortune tellers and tell them, you be the judge. Who's right and who's wrong? Who stole, who didn't steal? Who killed, who murdered, who didn't murder, and so on and so forth. Right? So, if we examine the history, it goes back. It goes back for centuries. People believed in fortune tellers. This is not something new. It's not a new business. But what's shocking is that today it's the age of the internet. There's websites, there's mass communication, there's universities, there's colleges, there's books, there's iBooks, for God's sake. You expect people to be educated, yet today it's a flourishing business. The fortune telling industry is a flourishing business. I read studies and reports that you have top executives, top CEOs of companies that go to fortune tellers. You have top politicians. Of course, they didn't name any because obviously there's a privacy law. There's politicians that go to fortune tellers. They want to know What does their future have in store for them? Lawyers, executives, you know, top, most successful people, they go to fortune tellers and they want to know their future. Why? Why is it? Well, first of all, we human beings, we're interested. We'd like to know what will happen to us in the future, right? Who are we going to marry? Who, you know, who's going to come propose to us, if you're a female? What am I going to be doing within the next 10 years? Where will I be? Will I be living in Montreal? Or will I be living in the UK or the Netherlands or New Zealand or the US or Iraq or Pakistan? Where am I going to be? Am I going to have any children? Am I not going to have any children? Everyone's interested, right? We're all interested in what will happen to us in the future. Some people are not just merely interested. Everyone's interested. Everyone has an interest. They're nosy. They'd like to know what will happen to them in the next 10 years. Some people are not just interested. They have fears. I want to know what will happen to me. A year from now, where will I be? What do my enemies have in store for me? Are they going to set a trap for me? Are they going to kill me? Are they, what are they going to do? Some people are very nervous. They don't want to be surprised. They don't want to be shocked. Am I going to get married? Some people don't know. Are they going to get married? Not get married? Is this person going to really come and propose to me or no? Is this person going to accept my proposal or not? They're very anxious. They're very nervous. For them, the future is very stressful. Will I have children? Or do I have to perform a surgery? What is it? You know, and they keep on asking questions. They like to know what will happen to them. They don't want any surprises. They don't want to be shocked or surprised, so they go to fortune tellers. And you know, it tells you a lot about this person. A person who has weak faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resort to fortune tellers and would want to know what's in store for them in the future. A person who has strong faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would care less what will happen in the future. A person who has strong faith in Allah will do what they need to do now. They will do their business. They will go to their school. They will finish what they have to finish. And they leave the rest for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Will they become successful or not? I'm sure they think about it. But they leave that for Allah. They're not going to go to a fortune teller and see, am I going to be successful with my business 10 years from now? Am I going to be on Fortune 500 10 years from now, or 20 years from now? No. They do what they need to do. They do their obligation, their responsibility. They do everything that they can, and they leave the rest on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person who has strong faith in Allah will not need to go to a fortune teller and will want to know what's happening. No. A person who has strong faith in Allah will depend on Allah. Will leave things in the hands of Allah. Of course, with actions. Not without performing actions, you know, sitting at home, not doing anything, and depending on Allah to make them rich. No, of course, that's not how things work. You do what you have to do, and you leave the rest on Allah. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. Say that nothing will happen to us unless it's been destined for us. So why are you nervous about the future? What's been destined for you will happen to you no matter what. And what's not destined for you won't happen to you. So what are you worried about? Leave things in the hands of Allah and let Allah take care of you. There's some people that always try to be in control of things. Be on top of things. Be in control. Instead of you wanting to be in control of your life, you wanting to know what will happen to you 10 years, 20 years down the line so that you'll be prepared, let Allah be in control. Leave things in His hands. And there's a difference between you being in control of your life or letting Allah be in control of your life. Which would you rather have? I would rather have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make decisions for me. I would rather have Allah be in control of my life than I be in control of my life. Because Allah is the best of planners and He will choose the best things for me. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allah, Allah, salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Now before we discuss fortune telling, and can we depend on them, can we not depend on them, what they say, is it true, is it false, let's first set a law. Let's first set a law. And this law is that no one knows the future other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what the Quran tells us. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that knows the future. وَعِنْدَهُ مَفَاتِحُ الْغَيْبِ لَا يَعْلَمُهَا إِلَّا هُ. He has the keys to the future. No one knows them except Him. فَقُلْ إِنَّمَا الْغَيْبُ لِلَّهِ. Say that the future, that the unseen is with Allah. عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ الْكَبِيرَ الْمُتَعَالِ. He knows the unseen. And of course, one of the aspects of the unseen is the future. قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Say that no one knows the unseen in this earth, in the skies, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus, no one knows the future other than Allah. Okay. How about prophets and imams? Yes, we believe they also know the future. And we will talk about this in a couple of nights, inshallah. We've designated a lecture on the imams and the knowledge of ilm al-ghayb. The imams and ilm al-ghayb. Do the imams have ilm al-ghayb or not? Because some of our Sunni brothers and sisters, they accuse us. They say that you give God qualities, godly qualities to your imams. You say that your imams know ilm al-ghayb. Is this true? Do we say that the imams have ilm al-ghayb? Do we give them divine qualities? We will talk about that in another lecture. But briefly, we believe that the prophets and imams, they do have some knowledge of ilm al-ghayb, but it's from Allah. Whatever they have, it's been given to them from Allah. It's not natural. It's not natural. They don't naturally have ilm al-ghayb. It's from Allah. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُطْلُعَكُمْ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَجْتَبِي مِنْ رُسُلِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will not show you His knowledge of the unseen. However, Allah chooses some. He chooses some, those who He wishes, who He wishes to have knowledge of the unseen, He will give them knowledge of the unseen. Thus, this is the first law. Let's get things straight. That no one has knowledge of the unseen, no one has knowledge of the future other than Allah and some of His prophets and awliya and the imams. Other than that, no one has the knowledge of the future. Horoscope, telling you what will happen in the future, no one has knowledge of the future. The ones that read your palms, the ones that have crystal balls, the ones that do tarot card reading, no one has knowledge of the future other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those whom He chooses. Those whom He chooses. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He was asked about the Day of Judgment. When is the Day of Judgment? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, answer them. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ قُلْ عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي فِي كِتَابٍ. They ask you about the hour. Which hour? The hour of the Day of Judgment. They ask you about the Day of Judgment, say that only Allah knows. عِلْمُهَا عِنْدَ رَبِّي. My Lord knows about the hour of the Day of Judgment. Does this mean that the Prophet does not know about the Day of Judgment? Perhaps he knows. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. Naturally, he doesn't know. But can Allah give him? Absolutely. Allah could give him the knowledge of the Day of Judgment. However, what this verse is trying to say, that don't ask me. You want to know about the future? Don't come and ask me. Only Allah knows the future. Don't come and tell me what will happen in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. Basically, Rasulullah is trying to close this door. You want to know about the future? Only Allah knows the future. I, as a prophet, I'm not going to tell you about the future. We'll talk about this more to come, inshallah. So who knows about the Day of Judgment? Allah knows about the Day of Judgment. By the way, you know, as a joke, they say that it was the Day of Judgment. And everyone rose. And one of the Shi'i, one of the followers of Ahlul Bayt, he also got up from his grave. He saw the grave next to him. Also, he read the name, also a Shi'i. So he knocked on the grave. He told him, get up. The man in the other grave, he looked up. He said, what's going on? He said, it's the Day of Judgment. He said, no, according to my marja', tomorrow's the Day of Judgment, not today. So I have another day to wait. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When we read the hadith of Ahlul Bayt, we see that fortune tellers, fortune telling, and those who go to fortune tellers are all condemned. They're all condemned. Islam has closed that door. Islam has closed the door of fortune telling. In a hadith by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, "Man masha ila sahirin," he who goes to a magician, "aw kahinin," or to a fortune teller, "aw kadhabin," or to a liar, meaning that the others are also what? The Imam put them in the same context, a magician, or a fortune teller, or a liar, meaning they're all the same. "Yusaddiquhu fi ma yaqul," he goes to him and he believes what he says. He believes this magician or this fortune teller. فَقَدْ كَفَرَ بِمَا أَنْ أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ. صَلُّوا عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. If he believes him, then that means he disbelieves in what was revealed upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That means he disbelieves in Islam. This is very powerful. That he who goes to a fortune teller and he who believes in what a fortune teller tells him. You know, sometimes you read the horoscope for fun, as a joke, for humor, for entertainment, that's fine. But reading it, to believe in it and acting upon it, you know, someone comes and proposes to you, he's a Scorpio, for example. No, I don't get along with Scorpios. I don't get along with Scorpios. We don't get along. That means you believe it. That's a problem. That means you believe in fortune telling. That's a problem. And that's what Islam says when Islam says no. We draw a red line. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now let's analyze this a bit more. Fortune tellers. What's their source of knowledge? Because just to tell you that fortune telling is haram, you're going to tell me, well, okay, it's haram. But that doesn't explain to me much. But what if I've been to a fortune teller and what they told me was true? You might say, Sayyid, I went to a fortune teller and what they told me was true. Just to tell me it's haram, well, that doesn't help much. No. Let's come and analyze, where does fortune telling come from? Fortune tellers, what is their source of knowledge? Let's examine. It's either 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are their sources. Let's examine these sources and let's see that is their source of knowledge. Is it authentic? Is it reliable or is it not reliable? And as you will see, that none of them is reliable. And that is why we say that fortune telling in Islam is forbidden and it's haram, and it's haram to go to fortune teller. Because their source of knowledge is all invalid. Let's begin. One, inspiration. There are some fortune tellers that claim to be inspired. Inspiration in Arabic is called ilham. They claim to be divinely inspired. How? I don't know. But they say that we've been divinely inspired, and this is how I know the future. I can tell you the future because I receive inspiration. I'm inspired. This, of course, is false. Because as we said, only Allah knows the future. And he told some of his awliya, some prophets, or prophets, all prophets, and the imams. And that's it. Yes, there are some people that receive inspiration. Allah tells us in the Quran. Some people are inspired. For example, the mother of Musa. وَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضَعِيهِ فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ فَأَلْقِيهِ فِي الْيَمْ وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي إِنَّا رَادُّوهُ إِلَيْكِ وَجَاعَلُوهُ مِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ Umm Musa, when the army of Fir'aun, they went door to door, killing all the fetuses and all the babies, Allah inspired her to put Musa in a basket and put him in the river. And she did. She was inspired. She was divinely inspired. Allah tells her, put Musa in a basket and put him in the Nile River, and we will make sure that he will come back to you as a messenger. He will come back to you as a messenger. This was an inspiration. By the way, Al-Shaykh Al-Ansari, Al-Shaykh Murtadha Al-Ansari, if you've heard of him, the top scholar, one of our greatest scholars, the one who renewed Ilm Usul Al-Fiqh, the Islamic legal theory in Shia school of thought. 250 years ago, approximately, when he wanted to join the Islamic seminary, he was from Iran, from a city called Desful, or Shushtar, in Iran. He wanted to come to Iraq, he wanted to come to Karbala and Najaf to study. He was only 16 years old. His mother was afraid of sending him. You know, she was worried. At the age of 16, sending him to another country. And it's not like you had airplanes. He could come every weekend to come visit. He would go and visit maybe once every 5-6 years. Or maybe once every 10 years. So she wasn't sure. Should she send him to Hawza or not send him to Hawza? So they decided on taking an istikhara. They took an istikhara and this verse came out. وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ We told the mother of Musa that let him go. And if you have fear, do not have fear, let him go and we will send him back as a messenger. Several years after, Shaykh Murtadha Al-Ansari came back to his mother as the grand marja of his time. Some people receive divine inspirations like the mother of Musa. But every fortune teller, every, you know, random person comes and says that I'm divinely inspired, I can tell you your future, this is going to happen to you? No. This does not happen every day. There are some people that are divinely inspired. You might say, well, some people, they tell the future. Someone predicted that this person will become president. You know, today in Canada, you have a new prime minister. I hear some people saying, I predicted that he will be the prime minister. I predicted that this person will win the elections. I predicted these political events. That doesn't require knowledge of the future. That sometimes requires knowledge of politics. If you kept up with politics, you will know that this person will be the prime minister. If you kept up with politics, you will know what will happen with the Iran deal, for example, or so on and so forth. This does not require knowledge of the future. This requires just being smart and being up to date and having knowledge of political events. That's it. This is not knowledge of the future. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. There are some that take educated guesses. You go to some that read your palm, or they have the crystal balls or the tarot reading. They take educated guesses. People think that they have knowledge of the future. They have no knowledge of the future. No. It's absolutely an educated guess. It's a smart guess. Let me give you an example. You're a young man in your 20s or 30s. You go to a fortune teller. He reads your palm, or she reads your palm, and she tells you you have relationship problems. Now, which guy in his 20s or 30s doesn't have a relationship problem today? That's an educated guess. That doesn't take a lot to assume something like that. Or a man in his late 40s or 50s goes to this fortune teller, and she, of course, they ask for their age and they ask for info. And she tells him, you're having financial difficulties. Which man in his 50s is not having financial difficulties? They're all having financial difficulties. These are educated guesses. They take information from you, knowledge of your past, your age, your job, your work, and then they give you an educated guess about what's going to happen in the next year or 2 years. You will meet someone. Oh, really? We meet someone every day. That doesn't take a genius to figure it out. Or someone will, they'll tell a lady, someone will come propose to you. Of course someone will propose to you. That's no brainer. Right? People assume that they know the future. No, this is not knowing the future. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Some claim to have contact with the jinn. And this happens especially in our countries. In some villages or at some Islamic centers. There are some that claim from the Muslim community to know the future. They tell you your future. And they claim to have connections with the jinn. And that the jinn provide them with knowledge. Now first of all, is it possible to contact the jinn? Is this possible or not possible? Let's get this straight. Two, do the jinn have knowledge of the future? After being in contact with the jinn, do the jinn have knowledge of the future or not? Let's see. First of all, the jinn are real. They exist. They're real. They're not fake. We believe in them. They're mentioned in the Quran. There's an entire chapter named after them, Surah Al-Jinn. They exist, no doubt about it. And there were some that had contact with the jinn. There were some prophets that had contact with the jinn. Maybe some of the imams had contact with the jinn. We have stories that Imam Ali alayhi salam had contact with the jinn. Does this mean that everyone can have contact with the jinn? No. Only limited people. Only chosen people. Some prophets, imams, they have contact with the jinn. But you can't listen to whoever says, I have contact with the jinn. Whoever comes on TV, or maybe wears a turban, or lives in your local village, claims that he has contact with the jinn, you believe them. No. In fact, there's a hadith Qudsi, a divine hadith, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that says, وَأَجْعَلُ بَيْنَ الْجِنِّ وَبَيْنَ خَلْقِي حِجَابًا وَلَا يَرَى خَلْقِي الْجِنِّ وَلَا يُعَانِسُهُمْ وَلَا يُخَالُطُهُمْ Allah says that I will put a barrier between humans and jinn. They will not see each other. Or at least humans will not see jinn. Jinn could see humans. But humans cannot see jinn. They cannot communicate with them. They cannot speak with them. This is a hadith. And some scholars believe that indeed, humans cannot be in contact with the jinn. Those who claim so, they're either crooks, they're either lying, or it's hallucinations. Some of them are not lying, but it's hallucinations. They think... once I remember, I was visiting a country and I was lecturing somewhere and I was in a house. Oh, they put me in a house. And it was a very old house. I'm lucky to be staying at a good hotel nowadays. I was staying at an old house and there was someone staying with me, in that house, one of the brothers in the community. And it was around Fajr time, we started hearing noises. We started hearing tapping on the window. I thought it was probably a raccoon or an animal. But the brother that was with me, he thought it was a jinn. He thought it was a jinn. If you think about these things, it will happen to you. You'll start hearing noises and you'll begin translating a regular tapping on the window that it could be a bird or a raccoon or an animal, you start translating it as what? as jinn. And this is very dangerous. This is very dangerous, even though if I go off topic. This is very dangerous. And I've seen people that they lose their mind. They lose their mind because they think about jinn and they hear stories of jinn. And you know, they hear stories of from their grandmothers and their grandparents about what happened in India or in Pakistan or in Iraq or Iran. This is nonsense. I will tell you, this is nonsense. Not that we don't believe in jinn. The jinn exist. But the jinn came and they entered this person's body. And they entered that person's body. And this is ridiculous. This does not exist. Don't think of such things. Don't be burdened. Because there are some people, they overthink. And they become crazy. They lose their mind. They're afraid of taking showers by themselves. They're afraid of sleeping in a room by themselves because they're afraid of jinn. So don't do that to yourself. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
So don't believe anyone who comes and says, I have contact with the jinn. I have a friend from the jinn that brings me news. No. Two, jinn are limited beings, just like humans. Just like we human beings were limited, jinn are also limited. Of course, they're different. But they don't have supernatural powers and they could do whatever they'd like. No. And in this verse, يَا مَعْشَرَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنْسِ إِنْ إِسْتَطَعْتُمْ أَنْ تَنْفُذُوا مِنْ أَقْطَارِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فَانْفُذُوا لَا تَنْفُذُونَ إِلَّا بِسُلْطَانِ. Allah says, O jinn and O humans, if you think you could fly out this universe and do whatever you'd like, do it. But you can't do it. This tells us that the jinn are limited. And their knowledge is also limited. The knowledge of the jinn is also limited. And the story of Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, Prophet Sulaiman had contact with the jinn. And he had jinn working for him. He had the jinn build him a palace. And he was in another palace. They were building him a larger palace. He would stand on his balcony and overlook at the jinn. And the jinn, whenever they'd see him, they would work harder. One day he was overlooking the jinn, standing on his balcony, and he was leaning on his cane. Malik al-Maut, the angel of death, came to him. He told him, are you here to visit, or are you here to take my life? He said, I'm here to take your life. He said, okay, give me a chance to go say farewell to my family members. He said, no. He said, give me a chance to say farewell to my children. He said, no. He said, give me a chance for me to lie down on my bed. He said, no. He took his life while he was standing. This is Prophet Sulaiman. If Prophet Sulaiman was not given the ability to sit or lie down, do you think you and me would be given that chance? فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. They won't be, we wouldn't be given a chance, a second. Anyhow, he remained standing. The hadith says, and the verse, for an entire year, Sulaiman remained standing, leaning on his cane, until insects, they came and started eating his cane until he fell. The jinn, they saw Sulaiman standing 24 hours a day. They kept on working, building his palace. Until he fell, they realized that Sulaiman was what? He was dead, and they were working for no reason. فَلَمَّا خَرَّ تَبَيَّنَتِ الْجِنُّ أَن لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ الْغَيْبِ لَا مَا لَبِثُوا فِي الْعَذَابِ الْمُهِينِ. The jinn realized that if they had knowledge of the unseen, of the ghayb, of the future, they would not be tortured like this. This tells us that the jinn are limited, even in their knowledge is limited. Furthermore, even if they have knowledge, jinn are religious and non-religious. Some are truthful, some are liars. وَأَنَّا مِنَّا الصَّالِحُونَ وَمِنَّا دُونَ ذَلِكَ كُنَّا طَرَائِقَ قِدَدًا. In Surah Al-Jinn. The jinn say that some of us tell the truth and some of us are liars. Just like whom? Just like people. Just like human beings. People also tell the truth. There are some that tell the truth and there are some that are liars. Jinn are just like us. They have our qualities. Some are truthful and some are liars. So even if they have knowledge, who says that they're telling the truth? Also, we believe that the jinn, they used to come to the skies and they would hear news from the angels. You know, they would spy on the angels. The angels would pass by in the sky, bringing news from here, from there. Some of the jinn, they would go in the sky and listen to the news, pick up signals. And this is how they discovered the birth of Prophet Musa. How did the astrologists know about the birth of Prophet Musa? It was from the jinn. The jinn told them. The jinn were able to listen to the news and pick up signals from the sky until Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. The year that he was born, the jinn were banned from listening to news. وَأَنَّا لَمَسْنَا السَّمَاءَ فَوَجَدْنَاهَا مُلِئَتْ حَرَسًا شَدِيدًا وَشُهُبًا. The jinn say that when we went to the sky, the skies were protected. We were not allowed to listen. They were shooting stars, banning us, burning us, not allowing us to listen. وَأَنَّا كُنَّا نَقْعُدُ مِنْهَا مَقَاعِدَ لِلسَّمْعِ فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعَ الْآنَ يَجْرِدْ لَهُ شَهَابًا رَصَدًا. And we would sit and listen to news in the sky. But now we can't. So from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, the jinn can no longer bring news. If they could bring news in the past, today they could no longer bring news. After the birth of Rasulullah. So if you hear someone saying that I have a jinn bringing me news of the future, I could tell who's going to get married, who's going to get divorced, who will live, who will die, who will have children. This is nonsense. This is nonsense. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
There are some that claim to have connection with souls of dead humans. They have connection with souls, and these souls, they bring them knowledge of the future. Some fortune tellers. Is this possible? Again, is it possible to be in touch, to connect with dead people, with souls? And number two, do these dead people, they have knowledge of the future or not? We, according to a hadith, we know that when a dead person goes into the next life, when a person dies, he goes into alam al-barzakh. And that's another world. He's disconnected from this world. And these two people from these two worlds, from alam al-dunya and alam al-barzakh, can no longer communicate. They can no longer communicate. That is absolutely impossible. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. When a person dies, he goes to another world. It's a different place where the dead can no longer communicate with the living. So how can this person communicate with a dead person and bring him news? In fact, who says that dead person can bring news? Who gave him the authority? Imam Ali alayhi salam, when he was coming back from Saffin, he came back to Najaf. The hadith says, وَقَفَ بِظَهْرِ الْكُوفَ. He stood behind Kufa, meaning Najaf and Wadi Salam. Wadi Salam is a huge cemetery. It existed from before the days of Imam Ali. Imam Ali alayhi salam was with his companions. He stood at the cemetery and he began speaking to the dead people. Naam. Ya ahl al-ghurba, ya ahl al-turba, ya ahl al-wahsha. Oh, the people of loneliness, oh, the people of darkness, oh, the people of the sand, oh, the people of the graves. He begins speaking to them. And then he tells them, أما الدور فقد سكنت. Your homes that you built, you spent so much money on, people are living in them. Don't think that your room is empty. No. The day that you died, they buried you. Someone went and they slept in your room. Your room is no longer vacant. وأما الأموال فقد وزعت. And as for your wealth, the Imam is giving them news to the dead people. And as for your wealth, it's been dispersed, it's been distributed. Your money is not waiting for you. وأما الأزواج فقد نكحت. And as for your spouses, your widows, they went and they remarried. Your wife, she went and she remarried. Your husband, he went and he remarried. And then he says, هذا خبر ما عندنا فما خبر ما عندكم. This is the news of us, of this world. Now you give us news of your world. عالم الآخرة. I just told you what's happening here. Now you tell me what's happening there. And then he looked at his companions and he said, أما لو أذن لهم بالكلام. If they are allowed to speak to us, which means what? They are not allowed to speak to us. If they were allowed to speak to us, what would they tell us? They would tell us only one sentence. One sentence. What happened to them at death, after death, in the grave, when they went into that world? What happened? They would summarize it in one sentence. What is it? إِنَّ خَيْرُ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. The best thing to carry with you is taqwa, is piety. It's piety. Thus, who says that we can communicate with dead people? This is one. Number two, who says that dead people have knowledge of the future? When we die, we will have knowledge. But knowledge of what? Of our actions. Of our actions. We will see our actions. The prayer that we pray, we will see it. We will see it physically. The majlis that we attended, the tears that we shed for Aba Abdullah, the food that we cooked for the majlis, all the good deeds and all the bad deeds as well. We will see them. We will have knowledge of our deeds. لقد كنت في غفلة عن هذا فكشفنا عنك غطاءك فبصرك اليوم حديد. We will be told that you did not see these things, but today the curtain is removed from your eyes and now you could see. 2020, you could see. Yes, we'll have knowledge of our actions, but other actions, we don't know. And finally, there are some that claim to have knowledge of the future from stars, from the movement of the stars, and these are astrologists. They claim that the movement of the stars has an effect on people's lives. When a person dies, lives, his income, his journey, his travels, the movement of the stars has an effect. Of course, this is nonsense. We do not believe in this. A person who believes in that, this is a form of shirk. Because as we mentioned a couple of nights ago, لا مؤثر في الوجود إلا الله. There is no authority except whom? Allah. Allah gives us life. Allah takes away our life. Allah gives us children. Not stars, not anything else. Imam Ali alayhi salam was about to set off to the battle of Nahrawan. An astrologist told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't leave at this hour. If you leave at this hour, evil will come to you. The Imam told him, no, I will not believe you. If a person believes you, that means he is disbelieving in the Quran. And the Imam alayhi salam, he set out. Yes, finally, I will say this, that there are exceptions. There are divinely inspired individuals that have knowledge of the future. These are a handful. These are not people that are showing up on TV. They have a TV show that are telling you, call me and I'll tell you if you're... No. These are divinely inspired scholars. Some of them are in Najaf, some of them are in Karbala, some of them are in Qom or in Mashhad. They're not going to come out and boast and tell you that I know the future. But there are some that do. There are some exceptions. Sallallahu alaihi wa sallam.